yet our best trained, best educated, best equipped, best prepared troops refuse to fight. Matter of fact, it's safe to say that they would rather switch than fight.
No justice, no peace. No justice, no peace. What do we want? Justice. When do we want it? We want it now. Ladies and gentlemen, to the Pick a Side Nation. This is your host, James Finney, with the Pick a Side Podcast. My guest on today's show is Mr. Najee Ali. It is my pleasure to have this brother who's been fighting for justice for a very long time to come into the lab. Sit back, enjoy, and I'll talk to you on the other side. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the Pick a Side Nation. Once again, I'm your host, James Finley, with the Pick a Side Podcast. Well, today, ladies and gentlemen, we have someone that's coming into the lab, a face that you guys have seen all the time, especially if you live here in Southern California and possibly beyond. We have Brother Najee Ali that's into the lab today. Brother Najee Ali, how are you doing, sir?
I'm great, Brother James. It's an honor and privilege. Thanks for having me. And I'm just grateful to be invited because I've seen your show. It's a great show, very informative. So I'm like, man, he finally asked me. So thank you.
Well, listen, the pleasure is mine. You know, I told a couple of my friends that I was having you on the show. And they was like, man, get out of here. And I said, no, seriously. I said, I'm bringing them on. Ever since I started this, you know, I've always been an admirer of you, man, because of your passion to hold people accountable and hold people's feet to the fire on certain things, man. And everybody can't do what you do. A lot of people just don't have the nerve to do it. Before we did the show today, man, I was just watching some video of some of the things that you was doing, man. You know, you got your sign up, you getting in front of police cars, and I'm just like, oh my God. And you know, it's just like, you know, we all have certain gifts, man. And I'm just really thankful, man, that God has placed this gift inside of you to do what you do. So, man, everybody kind of knows what you do, man. So why don't you start by letting everybody kind of know when you got that itch to start off with the activism that you've been doing?
Well, I would say I've been an activist my whole life. The first time that I really worked politically was in college, 1984. Reverend Jesse Jackson ran for the Democratic nomination for president. And I was a campaign volunteer in South Central LA at his office. And for some reason or not, whenever the Reverend Jackson came to LA from Chicago, he would always have me with him. And I was myself, wow, I'm with Reverend Jesse Jackson, you know, campaigning. And ultimately, I was always by his side when he was in LA and, you know, became this, you know, unofficial aide. So that was my first campaign that I ever worked on. And I thought to myself, it was very inspiring because, you know, obviously he did not win the nomination. But I tell people, had it just Jesse Jackson not laid the foundation in 1984 and 1988 when he ran again, there would have not been a Barack Obama.
That's right.
So I'm grateful that I had a chance to be there at the ground level with Reverend Jesse Jackson, who, whether you agree with him or not, he's still a civil rights icon, someone who marched with King, worked with King, and was mentored by Dr. Martin Luther King.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, one of the first cases where where I saw you, where I was like, wow, so this brother's doing a whole lot, was the case where the young girl, I want to say Harlan, she went into the liquor store and she was shot by the Korean lady.
Never will forget it. March 16th, 1991, Latasha Hollins, a 15-year-old black girl from our neighborhood in South Central, walked into a liquor store to buy a bottle of orange juice, had a dispute with Soon Dae Joo, the liquor store owner, and ultimately Latasha, as she's walking out the store, gets shot in the back of her head. You know, she gets her brains blown out. And I can remember my whole neighborhood were outraged because at the end of the day, you know, we're talking about like a young black girl, you know, a child basically, who was murdered by, you know, what we viewed as an outsider.
Right.
Get her brains blown out over a bottle of $1.65 orange juice.
Yeah.
So that was something that really, you know, moved me. I supported, you know, Latasha's family. And ultimately, it was something I think really helped guide me to be determined to fight for black people, because it's something Malcolm X said, the black women are the most disrespected people on the face of the earth. The murder of this young black girl just demonstrated what Malcolm X said, and it hasn't stopped, it's continued.
With
Usher Harlins in 1991, Breonna Taylor, 2020. The murder of black women still continues.
Yeah, and you know that case, you know, it made national news, and you know, your face was splattered on all the local news stations out here. So from that case, back in 1991, you've like literally from 1991 up until the present time right now, you've been fighting this fight. What is it like to have to walk into somebody's home where tragedy has hit that home? What is that like for you, and what type of preparations mentally do you have to make when you're going to go visit someone where their loved ones have just been murdered?
Well, actually, it's tough to be honest, because ultimately it's sad, and I can see people's facial expression when I do walk in. It's one where they're glad to see me, be there to help them, but it's also that look like, well, damn, you know, we thought we'd never see this brother coming into our household to help advocate for the loss of our loved one. So certainly it's draining. I do a lot of self-care, because certainly when your people are murdered unjustly, it does take a emotional toll on you. And there's certain murders, such as Latasha Hollins, you never forget. Sharisa Iverson is another murder that I'll never forget. 7-year-old black child, South Central LA, May 25th, 1997, was kidnapped, raped, tortured, murdered in a Las Vegas casino bathroom by this young white kid named Jeremy Strohmeyer. So ultimately, it's those types of cases where, you know, children, you know, are raped and murdered, that you want to make sure that you fight as hard as you can to get them justice.
So what is the process when, after you have reached out to someone's family and to let them know, hey, listen, we're going to be fighting for you. And then I'm quite sure that there's a situation where you have to reach out to the police to make sure that the police are going to hold accountable whoever that person is that has committed that crime. So what's the relationship with you and the police department when you're going down there to fight for an individual to make sure that justice is served?
Well, at the end of the day, and I've always said this, I am not anti-police or anti-law enforcement.
Right.
I am anti-police abuse, anti-police murder of unarmed black men, women, and children, murder of our people that's unjustified. So for me, I don't have a problem working with law enforcement. On the other hand, to bring to justice those people who also murder unjustly black people in our community. So at the end of the day, you know, we say Black Lives Matter, and we'll rush out and protest the police when our people are murdered unjustly, as we should. But that same token, we just got to be just as hard, or even harder, on the black murderers in South Central LA, or in urban cities across America, who kill black people that look just like you and I unjustly. And let those families know, at the end of the day, we have to hold our own people accountable. So I've always said this nonsense about no snitching. No, it's about holding people accountable and turning in murderers, turn them in. Yes, we don't want them killing anyone else. So, yes, I say at the end of the day, we must cooperate with police when our people are murdered.
I'm so glad that you brought that that up, because there's a lot of people. I have peers that believe that you are not for the police, and I'm like, there's a difference. I said, what this brother's doing. I said he's holding the police accountable. If it's a situation to where they need to be held accountable, then yeah, that's what he does. But you know, the brother ain't never said, you know, I'm not for the police or anything like that. And I think that's one of the biggest misconceptions that people have with you is the fact that, like, you know, just because, you know, you might be outside of a police station protesting or something like that, that means that you do not, you know, you don't want to have any dealings with the police. I mean, listen, we need to be policed. I mean, we need to have some type of governorship rule or something in the community. Now, what I don't like is the fact that when we are in South Central Los Angeles, now I stay in Koreatown. In Koreatown, we have Korean officers, as well as we have an abundance of Hispanic officers. Mm-hmm. And so I can't, for the life of me, in South Central Los Angeles, why is it that we can't have an abundance of black officers in our community, and why we always had to have so many white officers? I've always had an issue with that particular situation, that those officers live way out in Simi Valley and Antelope Valley, and they coming all the way down here. Why can't we be policed by our own police officers? Do you have an answer for that?
Well, I do know we've been in communication with Chief Moore, myself and other black leaders, asking that there be more diversity and representation in South LA, because obviously we feel that black officers would be able to relate better culturally to dealing with residents of South LA, because they understand the community, the culture, and how to communicate with our own people. So we think it's very important that there be more black officers deployed to South LA, so we can have a better dialogue and a better understanding as far as culturally the dynamics.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So let's go back a few months ago. And I think that 2020 has been like no other. I mean, I can't remember another year where we've had so much, you know, toil and pain and suffering that we've had like this particular year. We know in January, Kobe was killed in a car accident, and then we were struck with the coronavirus, and it just really just changed pretty much everything on what we do with our lives. But let's talk about when that young brother had that knee to the neck. And when you saw that, what went through you?
Yeah, and for clarity, Kobe and his daughter, Gigi, seven others perished in a helicopter crash.
Right.
But to your point, George Floyd, no one forget it. I'm watching CNN, and I look on the screen and see, you know, this black man with this white police officer's knee on his neck for over a minute. And I was like shocked, like, okay, is he going to take his knee off this man's neck before he kills him? And then you hear George Floyd on the videotape saying, I can't breathe. I can't breathe. And then he yells out for his mother, cries out for his mother. Keep in mind, his mother's dead.
Yeah.
So I was essentially traumatized seeing the murder of a black man on videotape, on CNN here in L.A., and true story, 5 minutes later, I grabbed my credit card, bought me a round trip ticket to Minnesota, and I don't have no family, no friends, nowhere to stay. I just had faith in God that, you know, we'll work it out. You know, I'll sleep somewhere. And ultimately, I flew to Minnesota to join the protest immediately. And I'm glad I did, because it demonstrated that when Black people are pushed to the wall, you know, we'll unite and then band together and fight for each other. I was joined by many other leaders, including, you know, my big brother and mentor, Reverend Al Sharpton, Sister Tamika Mallory, Sister Linda Sossor, and activists all across the nation who flew to Minnesota to fight for justice.
Listen, I was following your timeline every step of the way, from the time that you stepped off the air, from the time you stepped off the airplane at the airport in Minneapolis to your hotel. I was following you every step of the way. And man, I was so glad, man, that you had the opportunity to go there. So man, what was that when you got into the thick of things down there, man? What was the atmosphere like, man? And what was the surreal moment for you when you were actually over there, where you saw where our young brother lost his life at?
It was surreal, and it was sad that, you know, Black men are still being murdered unjustly by white police officers, primarily nationwide. So for me, I was glad to be there to show my solidarity. And the one thing I know for a fact, when folks who lived there found out that I was from LA, they were like, oh my God, you came way from California to help us? I was like, yes, because we must help each other in a crisis like this. So yeah, the response was very encouraging. And I know ultimately, at the end of the day, I was just glad to represent, you know, my home, my city of LA, let them know South Central's here.
Yeah. And, you know, I saw you engaging with so many of the individuals that were down in Minnesota from all walks of life, you know, white folks, you know, and from the optics, from what I was looking at on TV, it seemed like it was just as many white folks out there protesting as it was Black people in Minneapolis. I do know that Minneapolis has a very high interracial community out there. So it was a beautiful thing to see, you know, so Najee, you know, you went down there to Minneapolis. Were you able to make it down to, did you go to Wisconsin as well?
Yeah. I flew also to Kenosha, Wisconsin, when Jacob was shot 7 times in the back, same scenario. I have an emergency credit card where I just keep $2,000 on it for emergency. Yeah. So I just charged me a ticket for $300 round trip, flew to Wisconsin and rented a car and got there to, you know, support his family. Went to the scene of the shooting and was there for 3 days of protest, where the activists there welcomed me. They knew that I was from LA. Someone had Googled me that was there and like, hey, wait a minute. This brother's Najee Ali's from South Central LA is here. Give him the microphone.
Yeah.
And they gave me my respect, and I was able to speak and encourage them, let them know we got to keep fighting for justice. And from Wisconsin, ironically, Louisville, Kentucky is a 7-hour drive. Mm-hmm. After I left Wisconsin, I drove to Louisville, Kentucky.
Okay.
Joined little sister Tamika Mallory, Linda Sossor, a prominent Muslim activist, and those who were protesting for Breonna. So I was able to actually do two protests in one trip, because the murder of Breonna was just as sad.
It's ridiculous.
You know, Black woman is sleeping in her own home, murdered, you know, by these white police officers, who are still free today.
Right. Let's go back to Kenosha, Wisconsin. I always am getting into it with my peers. We saw on video where it seems like the young man, there was an opportunity for him to comply. Now, it's a thin line Because I always teach my son. I say, hey, son, you know, when you get pulled over by the police, you know, there are some things that I need you to do. You know, turn your light on in the car, put your hands on the steering wheel, and just comply. You know, even if you know that they're wrong, I just want you to live to see another day. So what's the thin line, Najee, when I'm teaching to my son this right here, and then you have other brothers that don't want to comply and then they get shot? So how should the community feel about that?
They should feel outraged, because at the end of the day, yes, of course, it's always very important to comply. But if you don't comply, good example, Dijon Kizzy riding his bike in South Central LA.
Right.
Did not comply with sheriff's deputies. But at the end of the day, even though he didn't comply, they had no right to kill him. They shot this man 16 times.
That's over a bicycle incident.
Right. So ultimately, if he would have complied, yes, he would be alive today. But that still does not give the sheriff deputies the right to be judge, jury, and executioner.
Right.
So when you
go back
to your original question about Wisconsin, Jacob Blake shot 7 times in the back. At the end of the day, I think for me, the police officers are the ones who were trained. They are taught to de-escalate the situation. But every step of the way, when we look at the video, they're the ones who kept escalating it. Jacob Blake was trying to check on his children in the car. Dijon Kizzy was running away, trying to get away from sheriffs. So when you look at the videotapes in both cases, they did not comply initially, but there comes a certain time and place on the videotape where you see these black men are the ones trying to de-escalate the situation by trying to get away and leave. It was the law enforcement officers who ultimately escalated it and ended up shooting. In Kids' case, he's dead.
So let's go back to that word, de-escalate. Do you feel as though LAPD, well, let's just say all law enforcement agencies across the country, do you feel that there needs to be some real extensive training on how to de-escalate certain situations?
No. They have the training because we know it for a fact, because they don't shoot white people like that. And that's how we know for a fact they have the training. It's only black people who are murdered unjustly by law enforcement nationwide. And we're talking about even children, where 12-year-old Tamir Rice, 12-year-old in Cleveland, Ohio, is on the playground with his toy gun playing as kids do, a 12-year-old, in 2 seconds, as soon as the officer in Cleveland, Ohio gets out of his patrol car on videotape, we see him shoot a young child dead. So when they say they need more training, no, they have training, because the training they do implement is when they find and encounter white suspects. They're not shot dead. None of them.
That is the first time I have ever heard it explained in that manner. And it makes all the sense in the world, because I've always been saying, hey, maybe there need to be some more training to be de-escalated. But like you just said, the white folks, they don't get killed off, you know, just, you know, they live to see another day. And so I've seen video where I'm like, my goodness, if that had been somebody black, man, the coroner's office would have been notified that there's somebody's here, you know, that's been killed. I mean, so you are so spot on with that. And so I guess that, you know, it still goes back to, you know, hey, no justice, no peace. We still have to be able to fight to make sure that these things are in place, because it just doesn't, it seems to always happen to us. So you, not only do you you look out for black folks, but you also look out for our brown brothers as well. So let's talk about the case that happened down in Compton a few months ago. So how's that particular case going? And let everyone know kind of what happened with that young brother as well.
Yeah, you're talking about Andreas Garrido,
yes,
a young 19-year-old El Salvadorian, just finished high school, was in Trade Tech College, and he was unjustly murdered, executed by LA County Sheriff's deputies, and shot in the back. And what made it more outrageous is that he tried to de-escalate the situation by running away, but was ultimately, you know, cornered in the alleyway of a mechanic shop where he worked as a security guard, and ultimately they shot and killed him. And the excuse was that they said he was reaching for a gun. But you know, we know that's the lie they always use when they want to murder someone and get away with it. The narrative is reaching for a gun, reaching for a gun, reaching for a gun. So we know ultimately those are nothing but lies, because witnesses who saw the shooting said ultimately he was shot in the back. The autopsies prove that. So we have, you know, another killing of a, you know, this time Latino young man. But I've always, you know, said to myself, I fight for the people. I don't care whether you're white, black, brown, Latino, Asian. If you are a victim of injustice, and my job as just a human being to fight, you know, for your civil rights, just like I would expect and want you to fight for mine. And quite certainly, we see that now. Where there's, be honestly, there's white people and people of all races now in this movement protesting the police on behalf of black people.
So let's jump over to BLM, Black Lives Matter. Now, you touched on some things earlier today in this conversation, which was we need to hold ourselves accountable to the black on black crime that keeps going on in our community. Should we put as much time and energy as we do when we are unjustifiably murdered by law enforcement as we do with black on black crime? Because you said something that in the community, as you know, snitching is something that is frowned upon, is bullied upon. And when TV reporters, police come over, start asking questions, everybody say, I ain't got no comment. No, I don't want to say anything. So, man, how do we almost police ourselves? Because to me, it's, you know, I don't want to have to say this. It's almost somewhat hypocritical sometimes when we're marching and this and that. But then we got so much crime, black on black crime, that's going on in the community. So what do you say to that, Najee?
Okay, well, I'll say it. You ain't got to say it. It is hypocritical. It's the height of hypocrisy when we have all these black on black murders of unjustly of our people, yet very few people come out and protest. And I do say, to give credit, there are some black activists who've been out there consistently, myself included, for the last 20 years, ceasefire, Justice for Murdered Children, Second Call with Skip Townsend. So there are black leaders and groups protesting black on black violence, but it's not enough of us. Because if a group called Black Lives Matter can organize hundreds of people to protest the police when we're unjustly murdered, then can you send 20, 30 people down to join us in South LA when we murder our own people? And that's the thing that's always bothered me, to see that they only focus in on black people being murdered unjustly by police. But when we're shot, when we shoot and kill each other, they're nowhere to be found. So someone finally explained to me, that's what they don't do. They just focus in on the police. So I said, well, they have a right to do what they want to do, but I think they have more credibility if they speak out and protest when our people kill each other also.
Yeah, I had the opportunity to interview Skip a few weeks ago.
Oh yeah,
and we talked about this, and as you said, you know, there's just not enough of us to, you know, to hold people to the fire on this, man. But you know, we always seem, and since you said it, I'm going to go ahead and double down on it. It is hypocritical because we put so much energy, Black Lives Matter, and then, you know, white folks, when they see the first thing come out of their mouths, well, how can you guys always talk about Black Lives Matter when it seems like you guys don't care about your own lives? You know, from South Central Los Angeles to the streets of South Chicago, I mean, Detroit, just all over the place, man. It seems like every weekend it's just a bloodbath of our young black men shooting down each other, man. And it's ridiculous. And it's like, you know, when is that going to come to an end, you know? And, you know, our local leadership here, we have an election coming up. And so, you know, we're hoping that some type of change is going to be able to happen with that. So moving forward until, you know, I have kids, you know, you have kids. So what does the future hold for our kids, Brother Najee?
The future is what we make it. And that's, you know, our job as being adults, you and I, to make a better future, you know, for our children. So that means we have to get out there and organize and fight for quality health care, quality education, more job training, more entrepreneurial programs, fight to make sure we have a clean environment, clean water, fresh air to leave, you know, this earth habitable, you know, for, you know, our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren, especially when we now see that there's a global pandemic, COVID-19, that shut everything down. So obviously, I think at the end of the day, you know, this city, community, this nation, this world will be better when you and I and others make it better.
And so what do you feel right now? What do you think is the biggest need is in our communities of color?
Jobs. Because at the end of the day, we talk about the high propensity of violence that's going on in South LA, in urban areas across America, whether it be Chicago, New York, Detroit. I think for me, someone said this years ago, and it really made sense. The quickest way to stop a bullet is with the job. Mm. So when people have jobs to go to, working 9 to 5 and having a paycheck every 2 weeks, feeding, taking care of their family, they don't have a whole lot of time, you know, for foolishness on the street corner hanging out. Absolutely. So I think ultimately, once we start being able to produce and provide more jobs for young people who are the ones who are actually doing all the shooting and killing, things will improve in our community, because at the end of the day, we don't see the amount of violence on the west side in Beverly Hills, or in neighborhoods of affluence, because those neighborhoods have wealth. You know, those young people have jobs, a future, opportunity. So it's up to us to give that to our children in South Central LA and urban cities across America.
Yeah. Well, listen, it's one last thing I'm gonna ask you about. So I grew up Leimert Park. That's my hometown. You know, I'm a product of Crenshaw High School and all that. So when I'm leaving K-Town and I'm going back to the city, I'm always in that neighborhood. And so on Saturdays, Sundays, mornings, I see different type of folks walking up and down the street, walking the dogs and this and that. So the regentrification in the neighborhood is changing. So what's your feelings on that? And will there still be a Leimert Park? Will there still be a place for black folks in the city to congregate, you know, when things happen?
There will always be a Leimert Park. Leimert Park is the heart and soul of black LA. It's my headquarters. Everyone that knows me knows they can usually find me there on Sundays at some point, watching the drum circle and talking to the brothers and sisters in the community. There during the week also. And I think when we see others come into our community, we should welcome them and embrace them, because ultimately, at the end of the day, we have to share our community, but make sure it's not taken over. Let them know that our culture is still going to be the dominant one, but we'll share, you know, some bean pie with you. You know, you can observe the drum circle and, you know, some of this poetry and arts and culture, but ultimately appreciate it. But it's ours. It's not going nowhere.
Listen, I was so the other day. I'm going through Leimert Park, and to see a line of white folks trying to get into the bookstore. And I'm seeing white folks eating on the sidewalk in Leimert Park. And, you know, I don't get upset over it. I love it. I'm like, man, I say, you know, the fact that you guys are patronizing our stores, man, you know, because it keeps our economy going, you know, as far as I'm concerned, man. But Brother Najee, man, listen, man, this has been an honor and a privilege for me, man, to have you on this podcast. Man, I respect everything that you are doing in the community. Man, the Black community owes you a gratitude of thanks, man, because anytime that there has been something going on where it has to come down to getting justice, hey, we know that your face is going to be somewhere involved in that, man. And if, for whatever, if God forbid, if you were to leave this earth today, brother, you have done your job, man. When they say, you fought the fight, you have definitely fought the fight, man. And if you can't fight another day, brother, you've done your part, man. I just want to thank you for that, man, personally. And just thank you, man, for being a beacon of light, man, because we need brothers like you in the community, man, where people can look up to. There's some young brothers, man, that's like, man, I want to be like Brother Najee Ali. And I'm certainly, man, I'm very happy, man, to have the opportunity to get to know you, man. And hopefully, man, as things progress with Pick a Side, that you'll be able to be a part of what I'm trying to do, which is help the community out in every way I can.
No, we're doing a great job, brother. You're doing a wonderful job, you know, giving folks a platform, like myself. Yeah. But I'm like, what took so damn long?
I'm going to be very transparent with you, brother. Man, I have always wanted to have a voice. I've always wanted to have a voice. And if it had not been, and I have to say it, if it wasn't for coronavirus that happened, I'd probably still be stuck in the same place that I had been in, because I was on a job that literally I was just stuck. And I felt like my whole life was surrendered to that particular job. Well, when I lost my job, for the pandemic's sake, you know, it opened up my eyes. When George Floyd, when the knee was to the neck, and then everything came into full circle. And I said, enough is enough. Now, you know, physically, hey, I'm like I say, I can't, you know, get out and walk up and down the street all day. But I was like, let me be able to do something that I can do. And that's with my voice. And I want to make sure that, you know, while I'm left here on this earth, that I'm going to make sure that I give people a platform to say what needs to be said. And I'm hoping that, you know, as time goes on and sooner than later, that God will bless me to be able to have a community center to open up to where I can have ex-felons coming in to try to teach them classes, get jobs. I can have people that are homeless to come in. I'm looking at foster kids over the age of 18 where they just get kicked out. I'm trying to help those folks out as well as victims of domestic violence. So, yes, brother, it has been a while, and I've been talking about it, man. But just know, man, listen, you've taught me a lot, and I appreciate it, man. And everybody asked me that same question, Najee. Man, what took so long, man? Because, you know, I know you have it in you, but, hey, listen, better. Hey, I'm glad that I'm able to do it now, man. And trust me, man, this is my fight, and this will be my legacy, man, as I continue to live here on this earth, man.
Excellent. Well, so proud of you, James. Once again, thank you for having me. And everyone watching this show can follow me on social media. I'm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. Just follow Najee Ali. So thank you once again.
Yep. And for those that follow me also on www.pickaside.org, we will have Brother Najee Ali have his bio up on there, so you can go and visit our website. So listen, thank you so very much, brother. We'll catch you on the other side, man, and we'll catch you down there over at Leimert Park, brother.
Thank you. Peace.
All right, man. All right. Take care.
All right.
I want to thank you, Pick a Side Nation, for tuning in to this another episode of the Pick a Side Podcast. We want to thank Brother Najee Ali for coming into the lab and doing this interview with us. Man, that was amazing. Hey, I do not own the rights to Fight the Power by Public Enemy, but boy, what a great song for a great interview. Thank you guys so very much. We're going to see you on the other side of the lab. Hey, always remember to hit that like, share, subscribe button. You guys have a good one. Take care.